Our members, I now call to order the security panel meeting. And this is the first meeting in the year of the RAM. I'd like to wish you all every success, enormous wealth, I'm not sure, but certainly good health. And this is what we are after. We are here till 5 p.m. today at this meeting, 30 minutes more than usual, with an additional item on the next generation smart ID card system is a follow-up from the previous meeting. All right, item number one, information of papers issued since the last meeting. We have received from Dr. and Chiang, a letter dated February 12th in relation to the item of medical parole, and she would like to find out about the situation. And the letter will be referred to the Security Bureau for a reply, and it will be up to Dr. Chiang, having read the reply, whether it would be necessary to follow up. Other than that, I don't think we have anything else in or by way of information papers. Now let's move on to date of next meeting and items for discussion. The next meeting is scheduled for the 10th of April. There are three items on the agenda for the next meeting. The first one is the migration or the boundary checkpoint management. We couldn't finish that last time. And the second item is the migration of the common platform for the police occupation normal index computer system, PONIX, and the criminal intelligence computer system, CICS. The other one is amendments to the first statute of the Dangerous Drugs Ordinance. These will be the items for the next meeting. So for the future meetings, do you have any particular items you have in mind that we should put on the list? If not, then we so decide on the 23rd of March, p.m., we're going to have a visit to the Fire Service Department. We'd like to find out about the operation and also the deployment guidelines and so on. As of March 1st, we have 9 members or panel members and 2 non-panel members who have indicated their interest to join the visit. So if members are interested in the Fire Services Department, I would appeal to you to attend the visit as much as possible. All right, on to item number 3. Shall we invite the administration in, please? And the item is relaxation of the upper age limit for Category B security personnel permits. Please refer to paper CB2 914/14-1503. With us for this item are Undersecretary for Security, Mr. John Lee, Principal Assistant Secretary for Security, Mr. Vic Yao, Assistant Commissioner Mr. Edwin Lam, and Superintendent Ms. Monica Al Young. Welcome. Please take a seat, and will you please take us through the paper first, and thereafter we will start our discussion. Members may wish to put forward their views. Thank you, Chairman. The security guards are subject to an age limit. Most of them are engaged in Category B security work, and they can provide guarding services for premises without carrying of arms and ammunition. The age limit is 65. In order to extend the working life and also to unleash the potential of the labor force, in January this year, policy agenda, we have proposed the relaxation of the age limit of the security guards. The Security and Guarding Services Industry Authority put together the guidelines in February, having regard to the population policy and also the regulation of the trade, agreed with all the recommendations regarding relaxation of the age limit. The sector was also consulted, and it was supported. The specific proposals are set out in the discussion paper itself, and they include the following 3 points. First, the upper limit for Cat B SPP should be revised from 65 to 70. B, a medical check requirement should be introduced for Category B SPP holders aged 65 or above, and for further renewal, there should be a medical check requirement imposed on them. C, the medical check requirement should be made a criterion that must be satisfied by an applicant and a standard condition subject to which a permit is to be issued. Subject to members' agreement, the authority will be amending the criteria and also the standard condition. Under the ordinance, the criterion will have to be submitted to the council for scrutiny. The Secretary for Security will be moving this in the Legislative Council, subject to LegCo's endorsement. It will be gazetted for implementation. I hope the members will support the proposal. Well, thank you very much, Undersecretary, for the introduction. Members do have their concerns to express. I'm wondering who would like to take the floor. Mr. Raymond Wong, Mr. Wong Kwok Kin, Mr. Leung Chi Chang. Mr. Yu Si Wing, and Mr. Kwok Wai Kong, Leung Chi Chang, Yu Si Wing, Alice Mack. 4 minutes. Shall we keep it to 4 minutes because of the sheer size of the agenda? Mr. Raymond Wong, Chairman, thank you. At the last meeting, I said that in principle I have no objection to the proposal to relax the age limit for Cat B security guards from 65 to 70, I accept this grudgingly, because at 65 people should be retiring, but people are struggling to stay afloat in the twilight years. Now you're asking them to get by becoming security guards. If they're physically fit enough, and they become security guards and to fend for themselves, and this is very miserable. Undersecretary, are you going to be a security guard when you hit 65? I don't think so. I think people are in a very, very sad state. They become security guards at 65. And the paper says that they have to be subject to a medical check and all the rest of it. And certainly, it is a kind of manual work because they have to make their rounds and they work for more than 10 hours. And we don't have standard working hours legislation. Those aged 65 may not be able to cope. So for this reason, I think for Cat A security guards and those working for the single tenement buildings, and there is no age limit, we have a real objection to that. And these those that are living or working in these single private residential buildings, at least they have one security guard. without any support, I believe they are making their rounds and they fall over and they pass out, and it would be very, very dangerous. So we've got to tread carefully. Now for these cat A and B security personnel, they have to be subject to a medical check every 2 years. Now many elderly people, because for financial reasons, they have to work as security guards, and I think the fees for medical checkup should be borne by the employers themselves instead of the security personnel. So I think it is a good idea for us to make the employer pay for the checkup fee. Now, many labor unions are keen on the idea of relaxation. They've done so much, and they can claim that they managed to fight for that during the election campaign. But why is it that you don't make the administration implement the universal retirement protection and the standard working hours? The means test for the fruit money and so on should be lifted. I think if you want to woo the senior population, you should do all of this, because that would be the answer to the problem. Of course, this falls outside the purview of your bureau. Now, you are seeking to raise the age limit, and people will have to get on with to carry on working in their twilight years. It is really sad for these people. 20 seconds. It is really sad.
In our consultation with the industry and also representative bodies, some security guards said that they are making a contribution to the society through their work. Of course, some are doing it for economic reasons, and some are still hoping to contribute to the society. Mr. Wong Kwok Kin. Thank you, Chairman. The FTU, and under it, we have a security guards association. We've been striving for it for a long time. I have to declare an interest. I am a member of the SGSIA. The rationale is this. In the society, in terms of medical technology, nutrition, overall, we are seeing longer life expectancy. People live beyond 80 years old. So for those who are now in at the age of 65, the so-called elderly, they are physically fit still, so they believe they can still work. Of course, Mr. Raymond Wong's points are valid. I agree with them. If there is retirement protection, then they don't have to work. But there is a difference here. Well, after all, the universal retirement protection will only give you, say, $3,000, and it might not be sufficient. So they still have to work. And also for the security and guarding trade, there is a shortage of workers. Well, we now are seeing full employment here, and it's difficult for the employers to recruit security guards. And actually, for my housing estate, a banner has been hanging there for a long time seeking recruitment of security guards. So if we make the relaxation, that will help the industry. Since I've joined the SGSIA last year, there was this case which impressed upon me. And there was this a security guard who's yet to turn 65, and he would like to apply for extension of his service. And the chairman of the OC concerned came to SGSIA and tried to make an appeal, and they would like to extend his service, and he was responsible, and everybody was satisfied with his work, and is found to be physically fit. And the housing estate actually is not very sizable, and they show us all the photos and diagrams. And ultimately, of course, I agree to the extension, but then the SGSIA as a whole refused his application, and they said that they shouldn't make a precedent because the law forbidden it. So the owners corporation's chairman was so disappointed. So I think we should strive for it. So in April of last year, I raised an oral question in the LegCo sitting and relaying my concerns. So I thank the government for following good advice and take care of the employment situation of the security guards and also the demands of the sector. So here I would like to register my support and to thank the government for your very expeditious action on this issue. So I leave some time for the secretary to undersecretary to respond. I agree that the security guards, although they are over 60 years of age, are still fit to cope with their work. And many of them actually would like to, as I said, continue to contribute to the society to enhance their self-value, and some for economic reasons and some others not. And they would like to serve the residents of the buildings, and they do show, I mean, they receive appreciation letters from tenants, and we would note all these. Mr. Kok Wai Kang, followed by Mr. Leung Chi Cheng. Thank you, Chairman. Our uncles and aunties are physically fit, so that's why we should relax the age limit. And also we have to take heed of the population policy. We want to unleash the labor productivity of women, and at the same time, the productivity of the elderly is not yet fully utilized. So we welcome the relaxation of age limit for Cat B SPP. And many uncles and aunties told us that they do have financial difficulties, but at the same time, there is another group who would like to do something. Well, their families are okay in a good financial condition, but they still want to contribute to this society. So apart from gaining money or salary, then it's another way of keeping themselves fit by staying in the workforce. So I would like to raise another point. I think the government should come up with some other support policies in addition to the relaxation. What kind of support policies? We don't have standard working hours legislation yet. On this relaxation of age limit, I think the government should consider proposing to the trade an 8-hour shift. And to some workers, they prefer an 8-hour shift, which can meet with their habits and so on. Second, not about age, but another point. Some private residential buildings have limited resources. They count on management fee to sustain. So there is always, sometimes, one security guard for working for a 12-hour shift. It's not like a housing estate. There are some other people on the shift, and there is a supervisor. So as we said, if there is just one security guard, he's making the rounds, and there is any accident happening to him, well, some people may have hidden sort of diseases. So is there any new technology where the trade or the employers can adopt to help the security guards in case of untoward incident happening seek assistance? Well, very often, these security guards work alone, and it's not like other situations where people have co-workers. Can that be considered? Thank you, Mr. Kwok, Undersecretary. We agree that all kinds of improvements can be made to security and guarding service practices. I would relay two points made by Mr. Kwok to SGSIA and also the police, which is in charge of licensing, for them to consider. Before a security guard obtains a permit, he should undergo training. In case of emergency situations, what kind of measures should be put in place? I think I would convey your point to the SGISIA to see if further can be done with regard to training. And I also agree that in our communication with the trade, and we would consider how we can help in getting a better mechanism to assist security guards in the emergency situations. Mr. Leung Chi Chang, followed by Mr. Yu Si Wing. Well, Chairman, I am all for this proposal. As some colleagues said, some housing estates have difficulties in recruiting security guards, especially for housing estates which are constrained in their resources. So they may not have very high requirements on the security guards. I'm not saying that those aged over 65 are inferior, I mean, in their work performance, but I think the relaxation can help increase or enhance productivity or labor workforce. I'm concerned about two things. One is about insurance, of course, labor insurance or employment insurance can be taken out. If the security guards are older, the risk will be higher, then that will drive up the cost. That may be a concern. And second is about MPF. About those above 65 are not entitled to MPF. And the employers still have to contribute, but then the employees do not, as far as I understand. So how are you going to deal with the situation? And also, Mr. Raymond Wong, talk about the fees for the medical tests, once every 2 years. So how would you follow up on that? Well, if the security guard is to pay for the fee, then that will add extra burden to the employee. If the security guard is physically fit and the employer finds him so too, should he undergo medical tests? And of course, perhaps you may not be asking the employer to shoulder the medical test fee, but would the government be helping out a bit on that front? Medical checkups. Well, I think we've been adopting a lenient approach. Well, the requirement for Cat B will be the same as for Cat A. So under Cat A, medical checks should be conducted on a two-year interval. So we're asking the Cat B people to follow the Cat A security guards. The fees charged will depend on the doctors doing the tests. To our understanding, it's around $200. We have studied the issue, and for Cat A security guards, they are subjected to this two-year medical checkup, and I think that has been affordable to them. So I think we will be following the practice in Cat A. Now, as for insurance premium, well, it's even more difficult to estimate for the each housing estate. It would depend on the location, the number of tenants, and whether claims have been made before. All these will affect the insurance premium. And very often, the insurance premium is borne by the employer. Now, as for MPF, we will follow what is required in Hong Kong laws. The employer must pay for MPF. In our communication with the trade, they show that they do understand all these issues. And what we want to do is we want to institute the change as much as possible. We want to use the existing mechanism and make things as simple as possible. If we introduce drastic changes, then that will take a longer time in terms of getting endorsement from the LegCo and getting approval from the trade. Mr. Yu Si Wing, followed by Alice Mack. Cat B, SPP, Well, for those under over 65, the same practice for Cat A will apply. Now, for Cat A, we're talking about single private residential building with only one flight of stairs. And if they can present the medical certificate, then they are allowed to work. For renewal of a Cat B permit, are there people who don't come forward for renewing the permits? And if they go on working without renewal, who should be held responsible? Is it themselves or the building management? So this is my first question. And then after you've given an answer, I will follow up. Thank you, Undersecretary. Thank you, Mr. Yu. For a security guard who would like to work, he must have a valid permit before the legislation is, well, the latest change is introduced. Your permit will become invalid after 65 years old, and that means that they are breaking the law, and their employer is also breaking the law. Now, statistics, from our statistics, it doesn't show that there is a serious problem. Employers generally won't hire someone without a valid permit. And of course, they can't take out insurance because illegal employment. So that can be dealt with by existing laws. Well, for some single private residential building, there may not be an OC, and the owners just pool themselves together and hire a security guard. And sometimes the security guards may have physical problems and they are not fit for the work. Have you received complaints like those before? And if there is really a problem, whose responsibility is it? Is it the security guard or the building? And for Cat B, after this relaxation, what will happen? I mean, if for this private residential building, they may not have an OC, and they will be bumping into the same problem. So that's why I asked a question about having any problems in Cat A. The security guard is breaking the law, and also the employer, it's breaking the law also, no matter is the OC or a group of owners. And if the police receives such a report, we will certainly investigate. And the police is also making checks all the time to ensure that the security guards meet with the permit conditions. There have been statistics showing that we have issued warnings and taken up prosecutions on security guards violating the permit conditions. For example, they fall asleep and they didn't make the appropriate rounds and so on.
So when we conduct the inspection, if the security personnel doesn't have the license or the permit, then he will not be allowed to carry on and action will be taken. Now, subject to this being endorsed, at the age of 65, those holding the Cat B permit, they will be able to work till 70, so we will have a reminder issued to them by letters to remind them of the legislative requirements so that they will not be breaking the law inadvertently. Ms. Alice Mack. Well, the labor union did meet with the secretary. We welcome this proposal. I'm glad that the Security Bureau has accepted our request for the age limit to be relaxed. The unions conducted some polls regarding the livelihood issues for the personnel. We also polled the security companies, and they talked about the difficulties in recruitment. Now, with more buildings being built, the demand for security personnel will be ever greater. So it would be a good idea to relax the age limit because there would be more job opportunities and the recruitment difficulty can be relieved. If I may put a couple of questions here. Now, there is a committee with the trade. Has communication started yet? The trade is very concerned about the fees that they have to pay for medical checkup upon renewal, or whether there will be overcharging that will take place. They hope that there will be communication with the administration. Now, the security personnel would ask that they are already at the age of 65, and when they the permit expires, they will they be able to apply for the Cat B license, or do they have to apply for a Cat A permit first before they will be able to get a Cat B license beyond 65? Now, if this is endorsed by LegCo, how soon will this be implemented? This is of a great deal of concern to the security personnel. Undersecretary? Thank you. Thanks very much, Ms. Mack, for disseminating a lot of information on our behalf. And this will be very helpful. So my thanks to Ms. Alice Mack there. Now, if everything goes according to plan, this should be finalized by the end of the year. Now, subject to the endorsement of the Security Bureau, we will be moving a resolution by the Secretary for Security. Subject to the endorsement of the resolution, the authority will be amending the standing condition, and the whole thing will be gazetted for implementation. We hope that we are confident, in fact, that this will be completed by the end of the year. Now, we keep constant communication with the trade. Now, we have a principal assistant secretary at the Security Bureau who is sitting on the committee. Now, the committee holds meetings on a quarterly basis. We maintain pretty good communication with the trade. Other than that, we do maintain a liaison with the sector. We appreciate the concerns of the security personnel in this area. We'd like to get all the legislative amendments out of the way first. Now, for those who are approaching 65, and by the time this is implemented, what's going to happen to them? Now, they don't have to get a Cat A permit. Now, if they have 3 years working experience in 5 years, or one year experience within 2 years, and they would be eligible. So they don't have to worry about the prospect. All right, unless there are further questions from members, I'd like to put my questions. This relaxation proposal for Cat B security personnel to work until 70, I welcome that. Of course, there are some members who are concerned about people having to work through their old age. From my experience, a lot of security personnel around the age of 65 would still like to carry on working to keep themselves occupied. And given the physical state, they should be able to cope. We welcome this. Mr. Undersecretary, will you address the issue of MPF? Those beyond 65 will not have any contribution by the employers themselves. So have you looked at the legislation? Have you discussed this with the MPFA? and can they carry on with their own contribution? So please enlighten us on this particular issue, please. Chairman, thank you. Well, this is nothing new. For Cat A personnel, there is no retirement age. And we will act in accordance with the law. Now, Chairman, we would like to have some discussion in the trade to see whether something can be done. We will refer this issue to the SGSIA. Now, for those holding Cat A permit beyond 65, the employers will continue with the contribution. Is it my understanding? Well, I don't have the information with me now, so I would like to refer this to the authority for consideration. Now, we like to replicate the same practice for Cat A security personnel. That would be the most straightforward. If we introduce anything new, it would be difficult for us to have this up and running within this year. In our communication with the trade, there is no strong demand regarding the MPF issue. All they want is to bring this in alignment with the Cat A security personnel. That's why we are putting forward this proposal. We will refer this issue to the authority for discussion. I've got nothing further to add to Mr. Chairman. Well, surely this has to be considered. I think the Bureau would like to follow the existing legislative arrangement. Now, for those beyond 65, and employers don't have to make any financial contribution. Is it what you're saying? Yes, I would like to follow the practice for the Cat A security personnel. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, well, if that's the case, then people working beyond 65, they don't have to have contribution to the MPF by the employer. The employers will save 5%. So they will be replacing those who for whom they have to make a contribution with those for whom they don't have to make any contribution. That's a loophole now for a 65-year-old. The employers will have to pay the contribution, but 62, they have to. Of course, they will prefer to hire someone at the age of 67. Well, sometimes all they need is just somebody sitting there, but it would give rise to a situation where some people will be phased out. Those carrying MPF implication will be phased out. Well, is it going to happen, Under Secretary? Well, Chairman, I'd like to emphasize that it is the category B and C permit holders and that will be subject to an age limit. The question that you talked about is a general labor issue. It's not a question for the Security Bureau. Under the MPF, how should we deal with the workers if they hit age beyond the legislative requirements? And that's a labor issue in general. It's a broader issue. Now, what we are saying is that we would like to lift the age limit, or to raise the age limit for two categories to a new age level. Mr. Leung, I think he has let the secret out of the bag. Well, it's not secret. Let me put it the other way. If you don't make the change, then people will carry on being Cat B security personnel without any MPF. So there is a bit of a discrepancy here for Cat B security personnel, but we're dealing with one single government, and they are merely looking at it from the employment point of view instead of from the security point of view. Thank you very much, Ms. Mack, for putting forward this proposal. She's trying to revitalize the employment market. Undersecretary, I think what Mr. Leung is saying will be applicable to all the sectors across the board. Now, there is no age limit on legislators. I mean, the two categories for whom there will be an age limit would be the two that I mentioned. For the others, it would be a broader MPF issue, of which I'm no expert. Mr. Leung, I'm not arguing with you here. Now, for those beyond 65, you have to ascertain whether they would be able to cope between 65 and 70. Would they be able to cope with the Cat B work? And you said they would be. Now, Ms. Alice Mack is saying, or Mr. Yip is saying, is that there should be more job opportunities. And if you create these job opportunities for which they don't have to have any contribution made in terms of MPF, then they will be crowding out those for whom there will be MPF implications. Right? I'm glad to see Mr. Leung Kwo Hong engage in discussion in such a gentle and calm manner. Now, certainly there is a possibility that people will be more tempted to hire older security guards for whom they don't have to make any MPF contribution. Well, they can have more in this category. Second round, I meant to wrap this up. Ms. Alice Mack, 3 minutes, please. Chairman, now we asked for a relaxation of the age limit for Cat B security personnel. Indeed, under the MPF ordinance, they don't have to have the contribution to the MPF by the employers themselves.
Our labor union will discuss the issue on the MPF arrangement. What kind of arrangement should be in place for this group of employees? And perhaps we should not make it mandatory or what? Oh, so that's another issue with the MPF. And actually, there is a tripartite body under the Labor Department in the security service industry. And some members have rightly pointed out that some employers may stay away from this 5% contribution, and they then, because of this, they would prefer to hire those aged about 65. But the question now is that we are shorthanded in the industry, and would they prefer one group over another? That's the question. So anyway, Undersecretary, please take our concerns and questions back to this tripartite body so that everybody can get a chance to discuss this point. Yes, Undersecretary, we would be bringing your views back to the body. I think this is a very good suggestion. So that's it for this item 3. Let's move on to item 4, and that is the construction of staff quarters for Immigration Department at Han Lam Street, Kowloon. The paper is CB 29014 /1415 /05, and joining us for the discussion of this item are the Undersecretary, the PAS for Security, Ms. Amy Wong, and Assistant Director of Immigration, Mr. W.K. Leung, and they are now coming in. And also from the Planning Department, District Planning Officer Kowloon, Mr. Tom Yip Chi Kwai. And also from the Architecture Services Department, Project Director 2 Acting, Mr. David Chat Wing Bang. Welcome the five government representatives. Before we discuss it, in accordance with Procedure 83A in our meetings, if members have a direct or indirect pecuniary interest in any matter, they should not move any motion or move amendment or speak on the subject before they disclose the nature of that interest. So please, if you have an interest to declare, do so. If not, then any? No? So I will now hand over the floor to the Undersecretary to take us through the paper. Undersecretary, please. Thank you. Where resources permit, the government's policy is to provide departmental quarters for married disciplined services staff. They can help address the housing issue for disciplined services and can help maintain our morale. Now, we have 30,000 officers who are entitled to staff quarters. And we have 22,000 units, 26% short of the demand. For R and F grade, the shortage reaches 48%, and the average waiting time is 6 years. If we don't introduce new measures, the problem will persist. In 2014 policy address, the CE said that we should expedite building 8 projects. And the aim is to, before 2020, we will be providing over 22,000 units to ease the shortage. Today, we are proposing to construct the staff quarters for Immigration Department, and it's one of the 8 projects mentioned. And it is at Hanglim Street 20, number 20. It will be a 15-story building, and it will provide 112 units. And if the funding approval is given by the LegCo, we can commence works by the end of 2015, and the completion will be in 2018, and the sum is $391 million. And we have consulted the Housing Committee of Wong Tai Sin District Council in December 2014, and the committee did not object to the project. We hope that you can approve this project proposal so that we can take forward this proposal to the Public Works Subcommittee and also the Finance Committee so that we can ease the shortage of staff quarters for R&F grades. Thank you, Undersecretary. Who will ask question? Mr. Raymond Wong, Kwok Wei Kang, UC Wing, Leung Kwok Hong. 4 minutes. Mr. Raymond Wong, Chairman. We have 4 agenda items in this meeting. This is a relatively simple, and we say we will be spending, say, 10 minutes on it. Are you asking us not to speak up at all? You just go through it as a motion, move the motion, go through the motion. I would be speaking a lot about on the ID card. And I think the arrangement is problematic. Well, the members have gone to the mainland to attend the CPPCC and MPC meeting, and some have gone to Germany. So why are we still having meetings when so many members are away from Hong Kong? And we have to be going around through different meetings, which are held at the same time. I want to speak on every subject, but then it seems that I am not given the chance. I cannot speak fully my mind. What kind of meeting is this? What kind of legislative council is this? Anyway, coming back to this item. And everybody thinks that we will support this. But anyway, I'll raise an issue here. The Development Bureau has been proposing increasing the plot ratio of size to increase the construction floor. For this Immigration Department staff quarters. Well, we said that there is an acute shortage, 48% short. And we are proposing 15-story building. Well, why can't the government lead by example, seeking the Town Planning Board to increase the plot ratio, to build more units, to cut down on the shortfall rate? Shouldn't you be doing that? Well, you should not be sticking to the old method of doing things. Shouldn't you be talking to the government? The development bureau has said the plot ratio can be boosted to increase the construction floor. We agree that there is a shortfall here. So shouldn't we be working hard to meet all the shortfall? Now, in paragraph 2 of the paper, well, the government has been very prudent in its wordings. It says that it is an established government policy to provide, subject to the availability of resources, departmental quarters for merit discipline services. What do you mean by availability of resources? Of course, we have a lot of resources. We have $800 billion in our reserve. We shouldn't be so conservative in our wordings. Well, because you're scared that we will not agree to the proposals. Well, the government has a lot of money, flooded with money. You are establishing various funds and so on. So what do you mean by availability of resources? Para 9, you said that there will be recycled features, conservation, but you don't have information on the cost effectiveness of the project. I think we still should have to study it. I think we're just trying to go through the motion here, and the main battleground is the financial finance committee. But anyway, Chairman, you have a figure for the number of units to be built. I think we can increase the construction floor area. You should try to build as many units as possible on that site to ease the shortage. I support in principle the project, and I think it would be better if you can maximize the number of units to be built. Mr. Wong, please leave some time for the Undersecretary to respond. I would like to mention that the details of the project will be submitted to the PWSC, and today we will be focusing on the policy, whether we would support the construction project for this staff quarters. I think we still need to have the proposal discussed at the PWSC, and we all know the current situation with the PWSC. Mr. Raymond Wong, you don't have to be unduly worried, and that has also to be discussed at the FC. And plot ratio, can we do better than 15 storey? Mr. Kok Wai Kong, if you look at the figures, it's like a 50% shortfall. We don't have any enough units, and the resources are limited. That's a fact. And we can now provide 112 units. We try to pocket them first. Well, in any case, this is a good thing. It will help them, albeit very slightly. What I would like to know whether the department has more concrete plans. Even if these 112 units are provided, the shortfall will not drop too much. What about the waiting time? To what extent can it be shortened? And would you have specific plans to increase the provision of staff quarters? We know that land is limited, and different departments are competing for land. So what is your long-term objective? Do you want to meet with all the demands, or we just try to ease the shortage a bit here? Thank you, Undersecretary. This is our established or our policy objective to provide more staff quarters, and we would like to identify more land to build staff quarters. Now, on this land site, the plot ratio is 1.6. We've already gone to the TPB to ask for increase in plot ratio, and the TPB has already acceded to our request, and this is 15 storey. It's acceded to by the, and it has been increased to 3.45. The TPB's consideration is not just on the height of the building, but that the building has also to be compatible with the surrounding environment, the traffic impact, and whether there will be sort of wall effect or what. So we will be providing 112 units. Future plans, yes, we do have future plans. At the immigration department, if our plans go smoothly, there will be another block of staff quarters, which will be in Kwintong. There are some 200 units will be provided. And with these two projects together, a total of 300 units will be provided. They can't satisfy all the demands that we agree. And in my introductory remarks, I said that subject to the availability of resources, quarters will be provided. Why this phrase? Because department staff quarters is not part of the service conditions provided. Is a benefit granted on a discretionary basis. And discipline forces are unique in terms of their job nature. We would like to provide more benefits to them. So we've been striving for more resources to do that. And one of the resources which proved difficult is land resources. We've asked all government departments to look at the sites they own, and then we can enhance the use of such land plots. For example, if a building has to be redeveloped or developed, and if, say, some buildings or some facility have to be relocated and the land is made available, we will look at those and we try to see if we can also increase the plot ratio in the process. And if buildings are to be redeveloped, then we would also be considering whether staff quarters can be provided at the same time. For example, if we're redeveloping a police station or fire station, we'll consider whether staff quarters can be built. This is our policy. Mr. Yu Siwing, followed by Mr. Leung Kwok Hong. And is this a policy, providing quarters? It's a benefit and not a policy. But then I think we should have an objective. Or should they be waiting for 5 years or 10 years? We should have a time target. If we have that target, then that would be help exert pressure on the management senior level so that they would consider allocating extra resources. So do you have such an objective?
Second, who will be eligible? Is it by rank or by seniority or by marital status or what? How do you prioritize the application? Third, you also mentioned Kwintong. This is also an urban area, that we're running short of land in the urban areas. So will you consider only urban areas, or are you going to consider the extended urban area or the NT? Undersecretary, thanks very much, Mr. Yu. Our objective is to identify as much land as possible, but it would be difficult to be specific about a figure. We have to seek more land. We hope that the department would be able to identify land that falls within the remit of the department. In terms of siting, we don't have any preference regarding urban or non-urban areas. Any possible sites will be considered. It will be up to the department to decide on the suitable location. They have to consider the operational needs. And this is a kind of welfare we provide to the staff. They have to strike a balance between various elements. As to the eligibility criteria, I defer to my colleague. When we allocate the quarters, there are three elements there. The first one is the seniority, the length of service. Second, the number of family members. Third, the pay point. And we would give a score to each of the three elements. And we will have a total of the scores and the applicants will be prioritized in accordance with the scores, and they will be allowed the opportunity to pick and choose the units depending on their scores. Mr. Yu, the pay point, what about the pay point? Well, the higher ranking they are, the higher the pay point. So the ranking has been included in the pay points. Well, that we're dealing with the rank and file. What about the citing? You mentioned that the decision lies with the department. They can choose urban areas or the NT. Now, for the immigration department, who's going to take the decision? Under secretary. It is a number of departments that will be involved in the identification of sites. It is the immigration, of course, that will be identifying the land. And the planning department will also be involved. And at some stage, the ASD will be involved. And depending on the land use, the town planning board will be involved. And the proposal will be submitted to the Security Bureau. And we have to consider the suitability of the site, whether there are any operational difficulties, and how do they strike a balance. So we do have the procedures that have been serving us well in deciding on these sites. Mr. Leung Kwo Hong, Chairman. Now, once they have departed from the civil service, and they will have to vacate the premises, is that right? Under secretary, yes, once they depart from the civil service, they have to move out within 2 months. This eligibility will cease upon departure. Mr. Long, will they be allocated a PRH upon departure? Under secretary? Yes, it all depends on whether they are eligible for PRH. There is a procedure for civil servants to make application for PRH. If they are eligible, they will be able to make the application, but they do so on an individual basis. Mr. Long, now why don't you allocate them a PRH unit instead of allocating the quarters to them? And I think you can procure PRH units for the staff, and that will obviate the needs for the construction of quarters. Under secretary, indeed, under the existing procedures, they can make an application with the housing department for PRH. PRH resources belong to the entire society, and the allocation policy it's not for the government, but there is indeed a procedure for them to apply for PRH. Mr. Leung, I appreciate that for quarters, you have to identify the site, you have to seek funding from the finance committee, and you have to do the design, and you have to provide the furniture and the fittings and so on. It's going to cost you a lot more than it would cost you to provide them with a PRH unit. Or put it this way, you can have a special category of PRH for those who are eligible for quarters, and that would save you a lot of headache. What if they have to move out upon departure? Maybe by the time they leave, they will be sold the PRH unit. And if they cannot afford a PRH for sale, who can? Now you have the Green Form Sale Program. This is precisely the category of people that you're targeting it. Well, Mr. Leung, I think you have gone off to a tangent. Mr. Yip, there are so many things tied to this quarters business. If the staff offered the PRH units, it would be more straightforward, and they can be allow the opportunity to purchase the units. Now, if they cease to live in these quarters, and they will be given the PRH. As certainly they will be residing in the PRH. Although when I was in prison, those guarding me told me so. Under secretary, well, these are two different policies altogether. PRH is for the whole of Hong Kong. Now, what we are talking about here is the welfare of the department in terms of housing, and there are two totally different kettle of fish. Now, when they retire, they can apply for the PRH. This is a personal decision on their own, because they are not doing so in the capacity as civil servant or a disciplined member of the government. So we're talking about two different policies altogether. Any further questions? If not, just a reminder that these are two totally different policies. Now, we're talking about the married quarters, and this is a form of welfare, and it is tied to the jobs. Once they depart the civil service, it would be a different matter altogether. And they can make application for PRH units, and the Housing Authority does consider these applications. By the time they retire, whether they will certainly get the PRH, it is not for sure. Under secretary, when you submit the paper to the PWSC or the FC, I'm wondering whether you can make available the information regarding the plot ratio, because we are very concerned about the issue of plot ratio. The TPB has given the approval. It's not as if you don't want to build higher. It's just that there is a decision made by the TPB. Well, certainly, Mr. Chairman. Unless, yes, I think what you said is correct, Mr. Chairman. I think you have put your finger on the precise issue. If you give PRH to these married staff, then there will no. There will be no question of plot ratio, because everybody would be treated the same. But they're not PRH units. I'm asking the department to get PRH units from the housing department. I'm not sure whether you are building a more luxury unit for the staff than the PRH. Well, I think you have really made the point already, and this is a form of welfare. Unless you have any questions, I'd like to ask members whether you would have any objection to this being referred to the PWSC. No objection, so all agreeable. So that's where we leave this subject. Moving on to the next item, item 5, creation of a deputy chief fire officer post for implementing quality assurance and training accreditation mechanisms in the fire services department. With us for this item are Mr. John Lee, Undersecretary for Security, Mr. Lee Kin Yet, Deputy Director of Fire Services, Mr. Alex Chen, PAS for Security, and Mr. Joseph Leung, Deputy Chief Fire Officer, Headquarters of the Fire Services Department. Please refer to CB2, 914, stroke 1415, bracket 06. I'd like to invite the Undersecretary to brief us on the paper, and then I throw the floor open for questions by members. Undersecretary. Chairman, the proposal is to create a permanent deputy chief fire officer in the headquarters for implementing quality assurance and training accreditation mechanisms. We'd like to consult members' views. It is the mission of the FSD to save, protect our life and limbs against disaster, with the infrastructure getting more and more complicated. We have more cross-boundary infrastructure coming on stream. The challenges facing the fire services officers are ever harder. In order to enhance some quality, the FSD has to develop a standardized quality assurance mechanism, and this Deputy Chief Fire Officer will devise such a system to make strategic planning in terms of quality assurance. And there will be forward-looking training mechanism to enhance the cooperation of the fire service, fire officers and the ambulances. That the training school will be completed in Zhengguanou. The fire officers will be trained together with an ambulance man, and this premises will tie in with the quality assurance system. Now, the QA mechanism is complicated. We do need to have strategic planning at a high level. So we do need to have someone with the right expertise and with the right foresight to take up the post. The DCFO will be sharing the workload of another DCFO who is working very, very hard with heavy responsibilities. And he will also become the head of the training school. Subject to members' views, we will put forward the proposal to the ESC in the second quarter of this year. Mr. Yu Siwing, please. Chairman, 4 minutes, please. 4 minutes? 1 minute? 4 minutes, please. Now, we're going to have the standardized quality assurance mechanism. This is something good because we have to move on with times.
For the headquarters command, well, how does our mechanism compare with those in overseas jurisdictions? What is the gap? And if we have the new post, will we be narrowing down the gap, or we will be outperforming the mechanism in other jurisdictions like those in the US and Europe? I will defer to the assistant director to give you the details. And I would like to stress that we are now discussing this QA mechanism, and we want to do a better job. And in fact, the FSD's competence and has met with international standards, and actually our services are highly respected. And I must say this at the outset. And after the new mechanism is in place, we would ensure that firefighters at every aspect of our work will reach meet with the required standards. Assistant director, or deputy director rather, the mechanism of FSD is in line with that of other countries. What we are facing now is that there have been many infrastructure projects with complicated structures, and there are also large-scale cross-boundary mass transit systems. And in the past, we relied on the individual districts to do their work, but then they may not be able to cope or rather share their experiences in these major incidents, inter-district industries with other commands. Also, there may be terrorist attacks and other incidents caused by inclement weather and so on. So how can we ensure that the different commands can reach the equally good standards to safeguard the public's safety? So we think that there is a pressing need for us to build a systematic QA mechanism. and that and I think we will with this new mechanism we will maintain our leading role in fire services around the world. Mr. Yu, I think we have a lot of buildings in Hong Kong, densely distributed, and we have different weather climatic changes, and we have a lot of exchanges with mainland, land transport, sea transport, aviation transport, so on. With the DCFO, new DCFO added, with that help us in leading well maintain our leading role, or is it that we would just be on a par with other countries? What's your thinking? FSD has this aim and we want to move ahead with the times. We want to develop FSD sustainably. And in order to do that, we must adopt the latest technologies to tie in with changes in mass transit systems and so on. And if we adhere just to our old pattern, we might not be able to do that. So we are proposing this new mechanisms to ensure that the frontline offices of services and performances can meet with the required standards and protect the public's safety. We are not just merely copying the standards from other countries. We would be building our own standards based on the local situation. Dr. Priscilla Leung. Thank you, Chairman. We all recall that there was this tragic incident in Shekip Mei. And because of this, we are worried about the training and judgment of our firefighters. And we are concerned about, first, the training and bricks, etc. for firefighters. Recently, I watched a TV report setting out the firefighting situation in Taiwan. The equipment seemed to be very inferior, of low quality. And in Hong Kong, that would not happen, is that right? We already got very advanced equipment, is that right? And what are the training programs that firefighters should take to cut down on accidents? And third, I'm also concerned about their welfare. If firefighters died in the course of their duties, and some of them may, bereaved families have faced difficulties in terms of housing. The bereaved family might have to move out after the firefighter has passed away because it was no longer in the post. Is this what is happening? Who to take that question? A deputy director. Thank you, Chairman. On the Shekip Mei incident, we established a dedicated group to look into the cause of the explosion. We would also be looking at the procedures that day, whether there is any room for improvement. For I believe that our colleagues are very vigilant, were very vigilant already. But how come that there was this incident? After the working group has completed its report, then we would be sharing that with you. As for those who died in the course of their duty, what about their staff quarters? We do have compassionate arrangements for them. The bereaved wife can apply for the department to continue to stay in that quarters until the date when the colleague should retire, then they should move out. So we've taken care of that already. What when they have to move out, will you'll be helping them to move into a PRH unit if their economic situation is difficult? Yes, they can apply for PRH. And actually, in the afternoon on the 23rd of March, we'll visit the FSD, and perhaps Dr. Priscilla Leung can find out more that day. Mr. Mlung Singh, I've also enrolled for the visit, but I'm not sure that I can join, actually. I would like to ask about paragraph 13 in the paper. Well, in principle, I support the proposal. Well, with that, the workload would be too onerous. One of the duties is to take charge of the operation and management of the new FASA. This is a new establishment, and actually two institutes are now shouldering out the responsibilities, and there will be the FASA, new one. When will it be commissioned? What is the workload involved? How many staff members will be trained up in that FASA? Deputy Director, I think the Fire Services Training School is also incorporated in that establishment, right? For this AFASA, we expect the completion of the construction work at the end of this year, and we would move in early next year and start operation right away. And we will incorporate the fire service training together with ambulance training in one under one roof. We would also take this opportunity to introduce the QA mechanism to try to accumulate the best practices and introduce best practices gained on site and then incorporate them into our training. We'll try to tailor our training to meet with needs at the front line. We ensure our staff will be adequately equipped to undertake frontline work. I think this proposed arrangement is in the best interest of the training and also the frontline needs. You would be having both the fire services training and ambulance training under the new FASA, and then it is now under the rescue command. So does it mean that the colleagues now responsible for these areas will withdraw from their duties altogether, or will they be helping out with this new DCFO for a while? During the transition, we are amalgamating the Fire Services Training School and the Ambulance Command Training School, and then move them to be under the portfolio of the new DCFO. We have a Deputy Chief Officer for ambulance training, and he has already a heavy workload. We will try to upgrade that post, and the senior officer will help the DCFO with regard to ambulance operations. We don't have any further follow-up questions. I would like to seek your views. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong. Thank you, Chairman. We said we should move ahead with the times. We'll build new hardware, and once we've got the new hardware, then we should try to better integrate them so that we can better manage them. More effective operation can be achieved. What about the software? The people who work there? I don't know who the DCFO will be in the future. The DCFO. First, Sometimes I visit your operations and I talk to the labor unions. They said that the remuneration is too poor. The ambulance man said, complained that the pay is too low, much lower than the others. The disciplined services, among the four disciplined services, the firefighters are having the less attractive remuneration. Immigration department is offering better terms than the FSD. Well, say, it's like a knife. You are allowing it to rust. You should try to get rid of the rust. I think the question is very clear, or the problem is very clear. The DCFO will be overseeing the training operations. I think you should enhance the remuneration of the firefighters. We're talking about 51 hours versus 48 working hours. You will not be increasing resources, and you will not be lessening your service level. And then you and people have a lot of grievances. Among the four disciplined services, the firefighters showed an especially heavy duty. They have a unique they provide a unique service compared to the others. So I think the structure is totally wrong. Whenever the firemen are criticized because of some wrongdoing, then I feel very sad, because we are being unfair to the firefighters and the ambulance men, especially those on the lower ranks. So my suggestion is simple. Why don't you give some money to improve their remuneration instead? And then if that is being done, then they will be more willing to take orders from the DCFO. We have to enhance their morale. You may accuse me of digressing here, but I think I'm looking at the root of the problem. If a person joins the police force, the immigration department, the customs and excise, and the FSD, I think among the four of them, the firefighters are paid, especially low paid. While the firefighters are particularly strong, I mean strongly built. They've got a big chest and tough muscles, and I think you should treat them well. You should not just be spending money, loads, sums of money on the hardware. You should also be trying to do something about their morale. Mr. Chairman Mao said something similar.
And your time is up, so I have to stop you there. I think we have to leave this subject. But before we leave this subject, I'd like to consult members whether they would have no in principle objection to this being referred to the ESE for discussion. Right? All agreed? Well, in fact, members have been full of praise for the five services department, and we are very, very proud of the FSD that we have in Hong Kong. It has been doing us proud. Right, moving on to the next item, the next generation smart ID card system. We've spent two meetings on this. At one meeting, we had about 2 hours of discussion, and during the second meeting, we have put this to the vote, and we have asked lots of questions, and the administration has given us a reply. And after discussing with the administration, I've decided to let members have another go at this particular subject. With us for this item, The same lineup as last time. Undersecretary for Security, Mr. John Lee. Principal Assistant Secretary for Security, Mr. Billy Wu. Assistant Director, Immigration Department, Mr. Lok Wai Man. Principal Immigration Officer, and Mr. David Chiu, Assistant Director of Immigration Department, and Chief Systems Manager of the Immigration Department, Ms. Caroline Fan. Welcome. All the replies have addressed members' questions, and they are in sufficient detail. Unless the Undersecretary has got anything to add, I would throw these open for members. Just by way of introduction, Mr. Chairman, this is the third time we come here to explain to members the proposal to have the next generation smart ID card system. We have provided further information regarding security features and privacy. Just before the meeting, we did make available the latest information to members. Last time, members talked about the OECD countries and the practices they have adopted. Following the last meeting, we have solicited information from different units and different jurisdictions. In this latest paper, we told members that there are 34 OECD countries, 17 of them, according to our information, do have the legislative requirements for people to have their ID cards. Now, we have also made available to members the countries that require the compulsory carrying of ID cards, and also the jurisdictions where the law enforcement agencies can require the production of ID cards. Now, in terms of the general operation, the design, and also the computerized system, I have brought along with me the Immigration Department colleagues who are familiar with these areas to answer members' questions. I have Mr. Raymond Wong, Mr. Chen Jicheng, Mr. Christopher Zhong, Mr. Ng Leung Singh, Mr. Yu Si Wing, Mr. Leung Kwok Hong. 5 minutes, please. Mr. Wong, Chairman, thank you. When this supplementary paper, it is silent on the fundamental information that we sought, and you're asking members to refer back to the previous papers, and I don't think it makes much sense. Now, like the OECD countries, I can log on the web and get information myself. Now, after two meetings, the Undersecretary must be aware that we are very concerned about privacy and security. The government tells us that they will maintain the contact interface in the new system, so there will be a good transition between the old and the new system. Now, without RFID, they can still make use of the contact interface. Now, this RFID will be superfluous. Now, for these new smart ticks, it's going to be there for at least 10 years. So we will have these two modes for 10 years. That there will be a wear and tear for the chips. Now, the government never told us about the wear and tear figures regarding the use of the chips. Now, this batch of ID cards have been around for 10 years, and with wear and tear, we can just replace them. It's just like when I get out of Hong Kong using the ID card. I can't really do it probably because of the chip is or has been corrupted. Now we can replace it with a new one. And it may be more inconvenient for the card holders, but we can still replace them. Now with the new ID card, it may be better technologically, but still they are subject to wear and tear. In the feasibility study, there may be security implications. Many people are concerned about the security element, the security features. I think the government should submit the part of the report that will not carry any security implications. And also, according to the Privacy Commissioner, he has received information that the Commissioner hasn't given his input according to paragraph 5 of the paper. Why is it that it is such a rush job for you to secure our endorsement? Now, when you go to the Finance Committee, you're going to be expecting similar questions, and there is some possibility of delays because of the insufficient information. Why don't you get yourself more prepared? Under the Registration of Persons Ordinance, there are, or the regulation, there are stringent requirements regarding unauthorized access to personal data, but there is no extraterritorial requirement. In 2013, it was reported that on Taobao, people can buy the devices that can break into the e-channel system. There may come one of these days where people can get access to certain devices that can break into the card reading system on Taobao. Now, this may be stretching it a little bit, but if you apply this same standard, it is not beyond the realm of possibility. So we against too much information being stored in the chips. Now for the existing ID card, the chips are rather behind times. What is the function of an ID card? To get it in and out of Hong Kong, to verify your identity, and to verify whether you are illegal immigrants. What about the other functions? They are not essential functions. You talked about all the loads of functions that can be built in. Driving license, e-health record, library card, the e-cert and so on. Now, last year you issued about 1,000 e-certs, and this is really absurd. As regards some driving license, that has been shelved in 2008. You're going to be spending $3 billion to change this from 36 kb to 80 kb, and this is not practicable. There is no need for you to store so much information in the ID card. Right, Mr. Wong always exhausts all the time, and there can be no response from the administration. Mr. Raymond Chan, well, the government is launching this new generation smart ID card. From the security point of view, it is more convenient for the government, but the members of the public are more concerned about privacy. And I would like the administration to review whether people should be made to carry the ID card, and if they fail to do so, whether it is against the law. I did put a written question. They talked about the OECD, 34 countries, only 17 has some similar requirements. Now, Estonia, I think it is a no, isn't it? They have the law. They do have the law there. So I think the government should review the situation. The government told me in the written reply that this should be kept on. And I don't think we have the opportunity to discuss this legislative provision. We should look at this first. As regards the technical issues, some members have already touched on this. The card readers can read mainland and Macau ID cards. And the government said that we cannot make direct comparison here. Now, what are the differences of the ID cards between these different places so that people cannot get access to the information? What about extraterritorial access? In the mainland of Macau, people can buy these RFID card readers, or they can buy a certain devices which enable them to get access to the personal data outside of Hong Kong. Outside of Hong Kong, I'm not sure whether it is lawful or not. So is it the case that people don't have any protection once they venture outside of Hong Kong? And people may be on dangerous ground. Now, let me take the question in the reverse direction, jurisdiction. Now, whether we are talking about the smart ID card or whether we are talking about any crimes, we are subject to the jurisdiction of different places. Now, it is for sex crimes that we do have extraterritorial jurisdictions, but otherwise we face the same problem as other countries, that we have extraterritorial jurisdiction issues. The focus is not so much whether we have the jurisdiction extended. The focus of attention is how best we can protect the ID cards of Hong Kong citizens against any intrusion. In the paper and here in this council, I've already told members that we do have a two-level authentication. Now, there are two levels of protection. Now, first of all, the range of communication has to be within 2 cm. With this new system, we may make it more stringent to below 2 cm. It would be just like opening a safety box at a bank. You have to open the door of the vault. Now, this optical card reader is the door to the vault. If you cannot gain access to this first door, you don't have to talk about RFID security. Now, even with RFID security, there would be double or many elements of security. You have to have authentication. Now, you talked about a device that can be bought at Taobao. I mean, you may waste the money there. Second,
We're talking about this encryption key, how the design can be made so that people cannot get into it with the algorithm. We also have the authentication mechanism. So in terms of arithmetic, if we multiply the two levels of difficulty, then we will come up with a very, very small probability. The probability is so small that it will be even less. The chances is even less than having two fingerprints similar, same fingerprints. So I think we have achieved standards and acceptable to the international community. We are adopting the same approach as Germany. Mr. Christopher Cheung, we have discussed this topic for two times. This is the third time that we are discussing it. I think we are over-worried. If the information can be leaked so easily, then it means that the octopus card, information in the octopus card can also be leaked easily, and we can easily lose money. $100, $500. But over the years, we haven't seen such things happening. Our information has not been stolen. Our money, we didn't lose any money. So I've consulted people in the trade, and in the trade told me that there is an NFC technology. It comes with a communication range of 2 cm. Is your technology similar to the NFC proposed by the trade? So this is my question. Undersecretary. Well, we are the highest level of technology within the NFC technology. There are different levels of technology within the NFC, and we are at the highest level. NFG is the latest world trend. Mr. Cheng also talked about Octopus Card. To protect or safeguard the privacy, we've built NFC standards. And within the NFC, we can have, say, different levels like that, you know, in a secondary school, universal, university, and professor level. So we're adopting the highest level of security here. Well, we are very clear about that. We talk about a communication range of only 2 cm, and in winter time, then, if you wear a coat, then you will not be able to reach that communication range. I think we are having the highest level of security here, and we don't have to be unduly worried. And I support the government adopting this latest technology. Mr. Ng Lang Sing, followed by Mr. Ng Yu Si Wing. Thank you, Chairman. The ID card has been used for a long time, and it's a fact that we have to replace it. We are worried that huge sums of money will be involved, and we must ensure that it's a value for money exercise. And I think it's just right that we try to monitor you on that front. Mr. Cheng mentioned about people having worries. I think if you look at it from a expert point of view, we'll try to ask the administration on the security measures that it would adopt, and the government should try to seek experts to help it out and to answer our questions. We should speak on facts, and we should not be unjustifiably worried. On the technology, I would like to ask the administration. In the original paper, paragraph 13, that's footnote 6. The OGCIOs will have a technical study and will study the review and recommend the architecture and framework for the new multi-application smart ID card, including identifying new data to be stored into the new smart Hong Kong ID card, and exploring provision of new value-added services. On value-added services, I think one of it has to be information or service to facilitate our statistics compilation. Is this something that you will follow up on? And also, the new officer to the post is an expert in technology. Do we need an ex-co member or an expert to deal with the subject? Undersecretary, Mr. Ng, thank you for your question. The OGCIO will study certain aspects of the chip as certain past panel meetings. Well, there will be two parts to the chip. One part will be used by the Immigration Department, and the other part for non-immigration purposes. For example, we do have information related to library cards and services at the LCSD, and also private public healthcare, e-patient record sharing, and so on. For this other part, which is relatively more used by other departments, the OGCIO is studying what kind of information should be put there. And for any information to be stored in this part, it will be subject to the consent of the cardholder. For the two parts, when we talk about very stringent security measures to be implemented, we are referring to the parts used by the Immigration Department. For the part used by other government departments, the information is used for a relatively simple purpose, and that is to verify the identity card number. And the security requirement for that part is different. What we are most concerned is about the personal information in the other part. Mr. Ng asked about whether any other experts can give input to us. We are working together with the professors of universities and representatives from IT associations and also alliance of IT products producers. We are sharing our information with them, and they told us that our security measures proposed are good enough, and they haven't raised any queries. We should not be getting in touch with this advisor yet. Right, yes. Mr. Yu Siwing. Thank you, Chairman. I think we need to replace the ID card. Mine is about to be damaged, and as technology develops, I think we should use more updated technology. And I think if in the course of replacement, then we can certainly raise our concerns and questions. Mr. Mok has raised a very good questions, and if you can answer our queries and address our queries, then that's good enough. Now, we've got a paper before us, and the Security Bureau has responded to us. I think we should have faith in them. I think the Security Bureau has conducted various investigations, conducted technical assessment, and then responded to us in writing. Well, I mean, I don't see why we should not trust them. I think I support this replacement exercise proposed. And some members asked whether we should be allowed not to carry ID cards around for the sake of protecting our privacy. I don't agree with that. Hong Kong is an international city, and many illegal immigrants are found here, illegal workers are found here. If we don't check on people's ID card, my guess is that the problem of illegal workers will deteriorate. Well, this is only my guess, of course. I envisage more serious problems with illegal workers. So has the government conducted an assessment on if the fact that if we don't check on people's ID cards, will the crime rate go up? Will there be more illegal workers? Have you conducted any studies, Under Secretary? With regard to our policy, I agree with Mr. Yu. The low crime rate we're seeing is a result of concerted efforts and the many laws in Hong Kong now. And I think our measures have worked well to crack down on crime rate. And I agree that we should maintain the practice of asking people to carry their ID cards around. And I think the people in Hong Kong have got used to that already. Well, without such a requirement, how should we be faring? I've actually inspected or checked on the criminal cases, which can be detected as a result of checking the ID cards. There have been illegal workers identified, and people who have breached their conditions of stay discovered, and some crimes are detected, possession of offensive weapons, possession of forged documents, drugs, and so on. So We authorize enforcement law enforcement officers to check on people's ID card, and I think this is an essential measure for us to detect crimes. Mr. Yu, you haven't done any formal assessment, right? Undersecretary. Well, for any study that we would undertake, we would come up with some results, and we would look at the indicators, and we would try to come up with a figure on cracking down on crimes as a result of checking on people's ID card. And actually, we've discussed that topic at the IPCC, and in our statistics, we do have statistics on preventive crimes. And preventive crimes have to do with our exercising of our powers to check on people's ID card and stop and question them. So what's the correlation between the two then? I think that needs a long-term study. But for now, even if we go ahead with the study, I'm not sure that we can come up with good conclusions. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, followed by Ms. Claudia Mo. Checking on people's ID cards. If there is a suspicion that this person is not a Hong Kong person, resident, then you can check on the ID card. Well, the police will not check on my ID card because they don't. They will not think that I'm not a Hong Kong person, Hong Kong citizen. Well, the ordinance there is not to crack down crimes, but rather to detect people, discover people who are breaching the conditions of stay, who should not be here in Hong Kong. Is this the objective of the ordinance? You're not there to crack down on crimes through this ordinance. Is that right? Please clarify. Undersecretary. If we are checking on people's identity card, our purpose is not just on ascertaining their identity. And actually, a judge has said in court cases that the purpose is not merely to ascertain the identity of a person.
Well, when you suspect that someone is likely to commit a crime, then you can ask for the production of an ID card, because you cannot really ask for ID card willy-nilly. So I don't think you can exaggerate this. Let's take protest, for instance. If I storm the court line, if I don't obey the instruction of the police, then you can ask me for my ID card because I am breaking the law, but you're not going to stop anyone and ask for his or her ID cards. Please do engage in a dialogue here. Well, if this is the case, then it would be against human rights. If you suspect that someone has broken the law and you're going to be making arrests, then you would ask for the ID card. Now, you are the undersecretary. And I don't think you should be acting improperly. It is when someone is suspected of breaking the law that you will ask for an ID card. You would not do so willy-nilly. Now, I think in most cases you're trying to verify identity. Verify whether they are Hong Kong permanent residents. If they are overstaying their visa and working in Hong Kong, then you can arrest them. Second is only when you are suspecting an offence that you will ask for the ID card. I mean, the more you talk about it, the more you're filling me with fear. Is that right? I will save other questions for the next round. Will you clarify for us in this regard, please? Undersecretary, Chairman, under the law, the law enforcement agencies are empowered to ask someone for the ID card. Mr. Leung, please, let the Undersecretary finish, because we cannot hear what the Undersecretary has to say. Mr. Lee, why can cite chapters and verse for Mr. Leung? We don't have to have a suspicion. It doesn't have to be a suspicion-based. Suspicion of what? Suspicion of whether someone is a Hong Kong resident. But otherwise, how else or why else can you ask for the ID card? So you're asking the police to abuse their power. And I think this short conversation is good teaching material. Undersecretary, why can cite the legislative provisions regarding the law enforcement agencies to ask residents for their ID cards? Well, I don't think the discussion should take place in this manner. If you want to listen to the reply, please have a listen instead of just saying that they are uttering nonsense. Ms. Claudia Mo, Chairman, the official is telling us that the reading range, communication range, is 2 cm. And it is within this distance that information can be accessed. Now, technology is advancing by leaps and bounds. Now, some members talked about the Octopus card. And the Octopus card doesn't carry your date of birth, and you're not mandated to carry your Octopus card. Now, this is a commercial device that you can choose to use. But here, you know, with regard to the ID card, it is a top-down business. It is mandated by the government. It is under the law that you have to carry. And this is causing disruption to the members of the public. It seems to me that you are rushing into this. This is the third time we've discussed this issue. And I find this wholly surprising why you have to rush into the whole thing. And you still haven't received the Privacy Commissioner's report. Now, why is there such a rush? This is all the more reason why I have to cast doubt on this. Now, the new ID card can carry the medical record, but I can have a choice. I can choose not to carry or incorporate my medical record. And I can choose not to incorporate the ID card, the library card into the ID card. I can choose to have the same data in the new ID card that I have in this existing ID card. I can do without the new value-added service. It sounds to me like an Octopus card. Do I have a choice? Undersecretary, when formulating policies, we have to consider the common or the overall interest of Hong Kong. We have to consider the Immigration Department's capacity in verifying identity. Our security features measure up to the international standard. Germany, Belgium, they are adopting the same security features. Now, given that privacy is protected, given that we have the security features, we have to decide on a system where we can achieve the objective in immigration control. Now, on a daily basis, and there are so many people getting in and out of Hong Kong, so when formulating policies, we're not simply looking at one single objective. Now, we are confident that we can achieve a good enough privacy protection and security protection. We would like to have a system where we can handle the volume of passengers. So we are adopting this RFID technology, which it will enable to double the amount of case that we're dealing now. Ms. Mo, well, I do have confidence here, but the major issue is as a cardholder myself, do I have a choice as to how much information is incorporated into the ID card? Undersecretary? Chairman, now for the identity verification and ROPR requirements, and they are mandated under the law. For the optional features, you can choose not to put the information there. It's entirely personal choice. But I must emphasize that we have to have a sophisticated security system. Please, did we have a choice, Mr. Chairman? I don't remember having ticked or checked or unchecked any boxes. Under the law, you have a choice, driving license and so on. So the answer is we're still going to have a choice. Well, I said many times, I like to repeat what I said. You do have a choice for the optional features, optional functions. You do have a choice. That much is clear. All right, the other point is why the rush? This is not put forward by the Security Bureau. At the last meeting, some pan-democrat members asked me to include this in the agenda again, so it is not me who am making this an urgent business. I think we have to make this a reasonable arrangement. Dr. Fernando Zhang, Chairman, it is not us who are making it urgent, but why the urgency on the part of the government to replace the existing smart ID cards? I understand that RFID is a new technology compared with the technology that we are using now, and there's going to be improvement in terms of security. Now, of course, the government would think that this is something good because of the high speed and more convenience going through the immigration clearance. Now, we are concerned whether data can be accessed remotely. Now, there have been protests recently, there have been confrontations, and people are concerned whether it would make it more convenient for the police to get access to the data of those who are participating in these protests or who are on the fringes. Now, all these are matters of concern to us. ID cards are a controversial subject in the first place, and there are many jurisdictions who do without the ID cards. In the US, which I'm more familiar, and they have been having a lot of debate whether they should have the ID card, and the government would like to have the ID card for the residents, but from the human rights point of view, many people don't really like the idea. In the UK, they did have the system, but they have done away with it altogether. So with regard to ID card, it's not as if it is without any controversy. With the improvement in technology, will that compromise on privacy and security on the part of the residents? So my question for the administration is this. Now, you are trying to introduce the RFID. How urgent is it? Three questions there. I think the second question has been addressed on many occasions. I leave it to the Undersecretary. Three questions there, Chairman, Mr. Chiang. The existing ID card system is beginning to age. It was introduced in 2003. Now, by the time we have the replacement exercise in 2018, the existing system would have been around for 15 years. Now, the maintenance period will be for 10 years. Now, we are liaised with the maintenance operators, and they would extend the maintenance until 2018, and thereafter nobody can guarantee whether it will be maintained continuously. Now let me cite you an example that there is an image storage system where they keep the fingerprints and the photos. In 2009, it was very efficient, 5 incidents in a year, but in 2013, the number shot up to 30-odd. Going forward, as there is wear and tear, the incidence of technological problems will go up. The chip wear and tear, we have 6,300 or so cases of chip damage. Now, what we are facing now is the service provider will guarantee the maintenance for 10 years. There will be an extension of 5 more years. The card itself will enjoy a guarantee of 10 years. Now, we try to find 2 laboratories in Europe to see how much longer the card can be extended. There is no guarantee that they can be maintained beyond 10 years. So the next thing to think about is to upgrade the system. When we reviewed the third generation system, the consultant told us that in 2014 we should replace or upgrade the system. Now, the first generation ID card was introduced in 1983. We replaced them after 4 years. The second generation was there for 16 years, and we have the existing ID card for the second generation. In 2003, we had the existing ID card.
We get the approval from the LegCo, then we will do it in 2018, and then that means 15 years for this existing system. It's more or less similar to the last replacement exercise. Question about assemblies of people. Will the information of the ID card be leaked or accessed? No, that can't be done. Why? I've explained many times. Well, of course, it's my duty to try to explain things clearly. I will try to do so again. Now, it's like a person getting into the safe deposit box. It has first go into the vault, and then the safe deposit boxes. So we have 2 doors to safeguard the safety and privacy of a person's ID card information. The first door is that there should be an optical card reader which can read the information on the ID card, and then the first encryption key can be generated, and then that will enable the chip to communicate with you. So that means you have to first get into the vault. Now, if you can't even get into the vault, then that's not getting anywhere. Let's not talk about the RFID first. We especially add in this extra layer of security, the vault, because we know that people have concern on RFID, so that's why we add in this extra door, the vault. And you must also use the optical card reader designed by ourselves. And there is this certification done by us. You say about the card reader from Taobao that can't read the chip. For example, in an assembly, and people want to read other people's ID card information, you don't have the card reader, so that can't be done. And second, perhaps through some magical ways and means, you can break into the vault. We come to the RFID technology, and it is the highest level by international standards. Belgium, Germany adopt the same technology. Of course, they attach a lot of importance to safeguarding people's privacy, and this is exactly the technology we are adopting. Apart from the encryption key, then there is another level of authentication. All right, you entered into the vault, you get past the optical card reader, then the system will transmit an encryption key to the chip. The chip is in a passive mode without a battery, and will only be activated through our system. And then after it is activated, it will look at the encryption key. And then if it matches, then authentication is done. And then it open up or establish a communication channel. But that doesn't mean that the second door is opened. Another or extra encryption key has to be transmitted. And then we can start communication. And all communication is also encrypted. So the first thing, you can't enter into the vault. 2CM is not the major concern. The major concern is you must use our card reader, and the card reader has been certified, has our own has our certification. So this is a high level of security. And then you must have this long encryption key or key test strain to open the door, and then another encryption key to another door, and then the communication is also encrypted. We've communicated with a lot of experts who have asked a lot of questions, but they never cast any doubt on our technology. And the same technology is used in many other advanced countries, which are paying a lot of importance to protecting their citizens' privacy. So in our tendering, we would ask the tenderers to adopt the latest technology at that time. Our aim is the same of members. We try to put people's mind at ease, and their security and privacy are adequately protected. Mr. Alan Lang, thank you, Chairman. The Undersecretary has been very clear. If there is a third party besides the citizens and the government who wishes to access the ID card information, they need to open the door of the vault, and they need to have an encryption key, and so on and so forth. Now, if the government wants to access the ID card information, what is the protection for members of the public? Undersecretary, under Hong Kong law, only the cardholders are authorized to read information on their own ID card. Anybody else is not authorized. If they do so, it's illegal. And that protection is enshrined in Section 12 of the Regulation of Persons Ordinance, also Regulation 12 of the Registration of Persons Regulations. So these are clearly set out, and what are the conditions where authorization or to read the information is, i.e. only the cardholders can access the information. I'd like to thank the Undersecretary to highlight the provisions again. Well, if in the case that somebody from the government, well, even if it means breaking the law, well, as what some members said, at protests and demonstrations, sites of protests, they would risk breaking the law and get access and to the information of the identity of those on site. I don't see how that can be done. As in my answer to Mr. Cheung, I understand what you're trying to say. Perhaps you want to get close to the participants in the protests. You want to read the information on their ID card number, I mean their ID card. Well, first, the Immigration Department will not give the OCR to a third party. The Immigration Department is constrained by law not to do that. First, so these people won't have our card readers. If they don't use our card readers, they may use their own technology. So what are the difficulties they will face? First, they may have to find a reader which have our certificate, but that won't happen. The second door, well, is processes another difficulty. You have to have an encryption key to seek the chip to communicate with you. That encryption key will not be given to anyone. Now, if, say, in the unlikely event of they having the encryption key, then they need another encryption key to establish a communication. I don't think that is impossible. I think it's impossible. That won't happen at all. And, well, is it because the card reader is so big that you can't carry it, or is it because you don't authorize it to be given to someone? Mr. Chu. Thank you, Chairman. The card reader sort of has information of that card reader has to be gazetted. So if you don't approve of the project, then we will not be providing the card reader. Is the card reader so sizable that it cannot be carried around? Well, we need your approval before we can have this machine or device. In terms of timing, the Undersecretary said that the existing system is around for 5 to 15 years, and it has to be replaced. And also, the contract for has expired, is about to expire, and our reserve can last till 2018. And if a large number of chips fail, I have to be replaced. I'm not sure we can last till 2018. So this is why the matter is very urgent. Now, you said that you have to gazette first before you install this reader. And is it going to be put in your office? Can you be moved around? Or if it is moved around, it will explode or what? You have to tell me the technology. Is it that the reader is not movable or what? Oh, well, we just want to know the answer. Don't argue with me. Student director, the reader now is fits with contact interface, and the new device to be built is also a sort of contact interface type of model. Without your approval, we will not be building a different kind of device, which is contactless. Well, I must emphasize that we are talking about multi-levels of security measures. Yes, I do understand. There are three gates you mentioned. And you said that the card reader can be moved to the site of the demonstrations. I don't understand. So it means that the reader will not be appearing on site, right? So it's my turn now. M- my question is the same of Mr. Leung's follow-up question. Is this a very big reader? There is this interface. Is it a very big device, or is it a small device? That's the first question. Second, can well, you mentioned about a 2 centimeters communication range. Can the range be extended indefinitely? I'll defer to Mr. Locke to take you through the technical details. The 2 cm is our requirement. If it is a distance beyond 2 centimeters, so the information can't be accessed. So information can't be accessed from a distance of over 2 cm, even if there is a reader there. That's clear. Let me explain. In order to communicate with the reader, there is this key test string. There will be a key test string, and that is made up of information from the ID card. So if the person doesn't present the ID card, then no key test string will be available. The card reader is just an ordinary type of reader, but then we add in a certificate and a special algorithm there before an encryption key is generated. Even if the person can get hold of our reader, they don't have our algorithm and certificate, they can't read the information. So that has nothing to do with the size of the reader, right? It's about the encryption key, yes. If members don't have any further questions, I think we should wrap up the discussion, and we have sought clarifications. So I would end the discussion of this item, and so we will move on to item 7, AOB, no AOB. So meeting adjourned. Thank you for coming. Thank you, everyone.